So I'm joined here by Cindy McTee, who's one of our pair of adagios. And I thought we're actually going to change the program order a little bit from what's in your book. So Cindy's piece won't be first. It'll actually be open the second half.
Yep.
But it's actually, in some ways, there's some real interrelationships between these two adagios. I mean, at least historically. I don't know, how much were you thinking about Barber's adagio when you were writing your adagio?
Quite a bit, actually. The DNA in this piece actually emerged in the form of an organ work in about 1998. It was not a piece that was commissioned. It was something I had a free summer, and I decided to write a piece. It was a luxury to have, you know, what am I going to do? Well, whatever I want. And I decided to work on something that was very introspective, which is quite unlike most of my music that most people know.
Have you written for organ before?
Yes, I had. And I was looking for something that would sustain a sound that would not require a lot of players. So organ seemed like a good choice, and I had a friend who was kind enough to play it. And then after 9/11, I thought about the idea of reshaping the piece into something that was not unlike the Barber. I mean, four strings alone. So Barber was definitely on my mind at that moment. And there are a couple of places that you might think come from the Barber, although I was not conscious of it at the time I wrote the organ piece. And subsequent to the composition of, let's say, a rearrangement of the adagio, I was commissioned by my future husband to write a symphony.
What's his name? Leonard something.
To write a symphony, and I decided to incorporate this piece into it because the piece had not yet been played in its string form, and I was looking for a home for it. It seemed like a piece that would work in a symphony, so that's where it found itself, and it was played for the first time in the context of the symphony, and then later I made a version for string quartet. So it's had many, many lives, and can be played alone, obviously. So that's a little bit of the history.
Yeah, in some ways it's sort of the Barber in reverse. Like your movement becomes part of a string quartet. His starts as a string quartet
that's
and becomes
true.
A solo
I about
piece.
That. That's right.
And you know, interestingly, they both connected to the Agnus Dei. I don't know. Did you
oh,
know that
I
Barber?
Oh, I didn't know.
So Barber later, so he writes the string quartet, he arranges it for orchestra, and later he sets the same music to the text of the Agnus Dei.
Be dark. I didn't know that. No.
Yeah. Which
the reason why this is interesting is that the my adagio is based on a melody that my teacher wrote in a choral work many years before that, the Agnus Dei from his so-called Polish Requiem.
So this is Krzysztof Penderecki.
Penderecki. And it was something that had been in my ear for a very long time, very beautiful melody, and I decided to incorporate it into this piece of mine so many years later. So I really didn't know. That's really interesting.
Interesting. So, and what was it about this melody? I mean, where is the melody from the Polish Requiem and the falling minor thirds,
yeah,
right?
I mean, that's it opens the Requiem, if I remember correctly, but okay. In my piece, we get there eventually. The idea was to compose to that place where the melody is fully revealed. But the intervals, the following falling minor second and then the major second, which outline a minor third, that's a very important interval set in the piece, and it's it goes up and down all through. And then at the high point of the sort of climactic moment of the piece, the melody is heard in full.
Great. Well, let's hear just the opening of your piece. Actually, I went to Cindy's website earlier today and stole the audio off of it.
Before we do that, I want to just explain a little bit about the opening is rather chromatic, as is the ending. And then in between, it's quite tonal or consonant. And so the piece has this trajectory of tension to a place of repose and then back to kind of a questioning moment at the end. So I don't know how far you get into this, but the opening is a sort of one kind of music, and then it evolves into something else.
Well, that's sort of what I wanted to talk about, is that because it's very striking, the difference between the consonant music that sounds a little bit more like the Barber, and then the dissonant music, which is much more modern or much more like Penderecki. And I wondered, you know, what was that Is that something that's in your musical language all the time, that tension between the two, or is this really something about this piece?
Yeah, it's a very important thing for me and many, many composers that, you know, that that all of the various harmonic materials that are available are usable sometimes in the same piece. You mm-hmm. know, that we can create tensions and resolutions and restfulness and anxiety using sometimes tonality, sometimes atonality in the same work. Mm-hmm. And it was very liberating to come to that place when I was a student, actually, but it wasn't in the air until maybe the 70s with, mm-hmm. you know, Rockberg's Third String Quartet comes to mind, and right. even some of the Penderecki works with the tonal moments, the borrowing from Gregorian chant and those kinds of things, mm-hmm. but it took me a while to get there, but it was very liberating to finally say to myself, and you know, and it wasn't my own idea, really. I was getting it from other people, the permission to put tonality and atonality together right. as have the advantages of both worlds.
And I think, I mean, that's one of the tensions I think about probably being a composer in the last 50 years or yeah. so, is you had to pick sides, right?
Right.
You had to either be the romantic
60s,
type,
you
the
had
conservator,
to pick
or you had to be yeah. like a serious composer and working with dissonance and all this yeah. complicated stuff. And it has a lot of interesting aspects of like music going into universities and music being seen as research rather than just as right. as something for the public. And so, you know, we put this whole label of seriousness on it, and it became tied up in like, are you Schoenberg? Yeah. Or, you know, are you, you know, doing something that's more accessible to the public. And I think what's interesting about your language is you've broken through that dichotomy and you're doing both whenever you want to.
Well, thank you. That was something I was consciously trying to do because I felt that it was leaving out something not to at least have those things available and use mm-hmm. them when they were serving an expressive purpose. It's hard to create, let's say, introspection and a sense of repose when all 12 notes are flying around the air.
Yeah.
You know, it's hard. Right. I guess you could. I suppose you can. There's some pieces that do that, but it's harder.
Yeah.
You know, so it was nice to do both, to have, you know, access to both.
Well, just so people can hear it, so I actually it's about in the opening 50 seconds or so, you hear both of these musics, I think. And it, to me, to my ear anyway, that more consonant world is in the very opening. And I broke it into two examples. So first I'll play the more consonant, you know, traditional neo-romantic world, and then I'll play this more crunchy, spicy, dissonant world. No, I think you can leave it on. Just after this, starting again, comes into this more atonal world a little bit. Really, really beautiful. It's absolutely gorgeous. How did you I mean, all these little cells and gestures that sort of laying. I mean, again, it's sort of like the barber. There's lots of repetition, and to me, it sort of creates a kind of reminiscence. I mean, these adagios, and you thought of 9/11, right? There's a kind of sense of mourning and introspection that comes from slow music, and it's sad, but it's also it forces you into a sense of introspection, and it's partially built into the repetition of those motives for me in some way.
I think also the falling half step is, mm-hmm. it conjures up those things. I'm not sure why, just from our life experience as listeners, I'm not sure. But it was a very personal piece. It took me a while to actually even show it to anybody or mm-hmm. play it for anybody. it just felt really personal, yeah.
And were you thinking of the Latin text for the Agnus Dei at all, or was that something sort of different?
Well, the Penderecki's text was in my mm-hmm. in my consciousness. It's so beautifully wedded to the melody that mm-hmm. it was kind of always there. When I think of the melody, I think of the text also.
Yeah. Oh, that's fantastic.
Well, thank you. You know, I want you to talk about the other wonderful pieces. Have time for the rest of the program, and I just want to say thank you to you for your participation and for allowing me to come on stage with you. And I also want to thank the DSO for this opportunity, and of course my husband for playing my pieces.
Fantastic, Cindy. Thank you.
Thank you.
It's always neat when you get to talk to the composer directly. You don't have to just listen to what the musicologist says. Well, let me back up a little bit. So we're changing the order of the pieces, and in part it's so Maestro Slack can actually use the barber in a way it's been used historically, which is as a sort of piece of mourning, of national mourning for important leaders. So famously, this piece was played at John F. Kennedy's funeral. And one of the things that's often said about music is that it takes over where words fail. You know, this kind of expression where we don't know what to say is when we turn to music. And probably Barber's Adagio is one of those pieces at a time when, you know, of complete shock, when someone doesn't know what to do, when words fail us, Barber's Adagio has often stepped in. And so for the assassination of John F. Kennedy in 1963, this was played at his funeral. This was also played at Ground Zero after 9/11 for the memorial concert. It's an amazing piece of music. As Cindy alluded to, it's from actually a string quartet that Barber wrote. It's the second movement, the slow movement, and then it was arranged for string orchestra. It's, you know, considered a kind of elegiac song. And what was fascinating to me, and you know, the fact that Cindy didn't know this was really curious, and is that Barber himself actually heard the same text, the Agnus Dei, the Lamb of God, you know, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us, from the Latin Mass, heard that same text in the background of this piece, but he didn't add those words until like 30 years later. Whereas Cindy's piece starts at the other end, it starts being imagined to these words, and then it becomes a string orchestra piece later. So let's just, you're going to recognize this melody, I'm sure, but let me play the later arrangement from 1967 by Barber himself, of taking the exact same notes that you're going to hear just without voices for string orchestra and setting it to that Latin text. And we'll hear that long spinning melody is really the characteristic of the piece. It's famously one of the examples we use in music theory classes of arch form. of a something. It's basically a long crescendo, if you will, that goes from you know, the softest of softs in the violins. You're going to hear this same sort of rising melody move throughout the different sections of the orchestra, and so you get these different kind of arches. It's like a kind of bridge, and there's a big arch, but also these repeated motives that are mirrored on either side, where the beginning, the very beginning of the piece, and the very ending of the piece, they, you know, and each sort of revolving around this center section, almost like there's a mirror in the middle. And what's the dramatic difference, the composers are always frustrating in this way, because they don't follow the rules exactly. They always do some quirky thing. It's called creativity. And that's that quirky thing that keeps us fascinated as listeners. And the quirky thing that Barber does to make this long arch form actually into something more interesting is he breaks it about two-thirds of the way through. There's this big crescendo, you're gonna hear the strings, there's this kind of shimmering intensity, and then suddenly it's like the entire bridge is gonna collapse, and it's gonna go from fortissimo down to pianissimo. And at that point, the melody's gonna just come back in this sotto voce way. And it's that sort of sudden drop, the break in the arch form, that's the sort of dramatic moment of this piece. And that, you know, in some ways the melody continues, right? So we live on, but something has happened, some kind of critical moment has happened that changed everything. And that's, I think, part of the reason why this piece works so well as a piece of mourning, because of the fact that this melody becomes this constant, and we have this almost this lingering melody, this retrospection that's brought into this piece musically, and then it has this dramatic form of transformation. The reason the piano's out here is actually for the second piece on the program, which is Leonard Bernstein's Symphony No. 2, The Age of Anxiety. Typically, a symphony wouldn't have a piano out in front of the orchestra, right? I mean, we would use this for a concerto. And in a sense, the Symphony No. 2 is a concerto, or maybe more of a conversation, if you will, between the orchestra and the piano soloist. So it's actually based on a book called The Age of Anxiety, which gives us the subtitle. This was a long poem that was written by W.H. Auden. It actually won the Pulitzer Prize in 1948. And it's a pretty modern poem. 1947, what would have just happened? Yeah, World War II would have just ended. And what was the dramatic thing that ended World War II? The bomb, right? So this is one of those moments that changes everything, right? The sort of nuclear crisis, the fear of annihilation. And in some ways, this poem gives the 20th century its sort of subtitle, if you will, The Age of Anxiety, a time when we're anxious, we're worried about a possible future, about the fact that humanity could actually rub itself off the map, right? So basically, it's a kind of a crisis of spirituality, where in the book, there are four characters. They're described here, Malin, Quant, Rosetta, and Emble, so three guys and one woman. And they're all symbolic in one way or another, and I think Bernstein himself was fascinated with religion, was fascinated with ideas, was fascinated with sort of the interplay internationally of different cultures. So he had a, you know, one of the things, I met him a couple times, and he would always stick around long after a concert and talk to every student who wanted to talk to him. So I would be in those lines a couple times. And he sort of, I think, amused himself by asking everybody their names and trying to guess where they were from in the world, right? So how did people fit together was one of the things he was really fascinated with. And so this particular poem, it's almost a book-length poem, a little book, fascinated him because I think it reflected his own crisis of identity, his own crisis of spirituality, which we heard a little bit in the first concert of the American Panorama series, if you heard that, with a example or three movements from Meditations from Bernstein's Mass, which was the piece that he wrote in honor of the opening of the Kennedy Center in 1970. So this is an earlier piece, but a similar kind of theme of him searching for sort of a spiritual identity. And so these, in the poem, the four characters go out to a New York City bar, and they basically, the whole poem is an extended conversation. And so that's really the conversation between Orly Shaham, who's our sort of last second piano soloist. She just got the call on Tuesday night that Genevieve Thibodeau was sick and that could she come and play. She told me just a few minutes ago that this is her seventh performance of Bernstein's Age of Anxiety this year because Bernstein was born in 1918. And so all of last year, a lot of different ensembles were celebrating the centennial of his birth. And this piece, which was pretty rarely heard, I had not heard it live until just last year, has now, you know, I think is coming back and is sort of becoming part of the repertory. And it's this fascinating interplay between, you know, this complex conversation of orchestra and soloist. It's organized like the poem in six parts, and the different characters are described in your program notes. There's sort of two big sections, and Bernstein illustrates a lot of the sections of the poem using the structure of variation, of taking a single melody and then using the variations in the poem to reflect the variations in the melody. And there's a, you know, basically they introduce the characters all are hanging out at the bar getting increasingly inebriated and sort of more open about their conversation and their anxieties. And then at one point the female character starts flirting with the young Navy character. But then at the end, they all end up just going home their own separate ways back into their isolated existence. And so it doesn't really end that optimistically. Whereas I think the Mass, as we heard on the first concert of the American Panorama, has a much more sort of optimistic feel. Then Cindy's piece, you know, will be now on the second half to open things up. And then we'll have Aaron Copland's Suite from Appalachian Spring, which gives our whole concert its title. This is from 1944, although this is the full orchestra version, which is orchestrated a year later, 1945. It starts out as a ballet, which is done as a kind of chamber ballet. It's actually commissioned by the Coolidge Foundation for the opening of the auditorium that's in the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C., which is a much, much smaller room than this. And so the orchestra is only 13 players. And then Copland, it's such a success, this piece, that he expands it to a full orchestral suite. The piece is originally written and commissioned specifically for a modern dancer, Martha Graham. And they were certainly friends, Copland and Graham. I think it was the first time, according to anyway the history I was reading, that a modern dancer had a piece commissioned for them by an American composer. And it very much, I think, defines the Americana soundscape that Leonard was talking about at the beginning, that we associate with Copland, that sort of nationalist pull, the fanfare for the common man and Appalachian Spring, I think are probably those two things that for us represent what American music is and what Copland's voice is. And Copland, of course, wrote into his ballets like Rodeo and Billy the Kid, you know, a lot of ideas of the West. In my mind, Copland really sounds, and this piece really sounds more like early American music, like from the 1770s and 80s, what we call the American psalmodists. And they had a tendency to use these open harmonies. I don't know if I can play this piano. It probably will cause problems, but these kind of a fifth or a fourth are these kinds of sounds that we associate with Copland. They have a kind of raw, ringing, open quality to it without the major or minor third at all. Right, and that's what we hear in the clarinet solo that's going to start out Appalachian Spring. Copland won the Pulitzer Prize in Music for this very piece, and it's come to define in many ways one of the sort of quintessential pieces of American music. What's interesting about Copland, and Leonard alluded to this, is we hear Copland now, I think, as a pretty conservative composer, as something that's very listenable. In Copland's day, I think he was seen or heard as much more modernist. And there's an influence of jazz, for example. There's a lot of rhythmic, it's not so much harmonic dissonance like we were talking about with Cindy's piece. The modernism of this piece comes in its sort of rhythmic fragmentation, the fact you'll notice, you know, the conductor, if we're conducting, Leonard's conducting a piece like by Mozart, or even the Adagio for strings, it's gonna be sort of the same pattern the whole way through, right? In this piece, Appalachian Spring, you're gonna see all sorts of different sort of asymmetrical patterns, things that are in threes and fives instead of in twos and fours. And Appalachian Spring is actually one of those pieces that they use to test conductors. So we just had auditions at the University of Michigan for our conducting program. Appalachian Spring is one of the things we have young conductors do, because it's a well-known piece, but it's actually really, really hard to conduct. Similarly, The Barber is actually pretty hard to conduct because you have to be able to, again, to lead this large crescendo. So the music may sound easy, but it's actually, the brilliant performances sound effortless, but they're actually quite tricky. The thing I wanted to show you here, give you a little bit of background into the Martha Graham piece. This is actually a video of Martha Graham dancing. And you can get a little sense of the modernist her that she's known for, because these are sort of balletic costumes, if you will, but they're not balletic moves. So this the video used to be incredibly hard to find, and as a music professor, I would get lots of kudos with my students because I had this recording. Now you can just go on YouTube, you could watch the whole thing when you get home. But it used to be really special because I had this, but now I'm not special anymore. One of the funny things about this piece is sort of the title Appalachian Spring comes from. So Copland's title was actually Ballet for Martha, because he was just writing this for Martha Graham. And the tune you had just heard is a tune that's a shaker melody. Do you know what the name of it is? Yeah, "'Tis a Gift to Be Simple," or "Simple Gifts." It's from 1848. And so in Copland's book, I talked about this a little bit in the last lecture, he wrote a book called "What to Listen For in Music." It's sort of the most well-respected or best-selling music appreciation book ever written by Copland. But he tells a story about different modes of musical listening. And I can actually show you these here. He talks about three planes of listening. And I will sometimes tell my students, particularly the music appreciation students who maybe haven't heard a lot of classical music before, you can follow Copland's advice here and focus your listening on one of these three planes. For Copland, as a composer, he finds one plane way more important than the other. So one plane is sort of the intuitive plane, the sort of raw connection you might feel with music, what he calls the sensuous plane. So does it make you feel tight or open or happy or sad? Those kinds of things, it's in that sensuous plane. It's almost a plane that we can't put words to. And then he talks about the expressive plane, right? What does it mean? What's the story? What's the particular message of this music? And then the sheerly musical plane. And so in his book, he spends about a paragraph talking about the sensuous plane. He spends about two pages talking about the expressive plane. And then he spends about 150 pages talking about the sheerly musical plane, because that's the stuff of the composer. That's the scales and the form and the instrumentation and all the details that he is so fascinated with. With the expressive plane, however, he says, you know, music doesn't really have a meaning. It's just really up to the composer, and it's very personal, and you shouldn't really talk about the meaning. Let me tell you this story. I wrote this piece called Ballet for Martha, and then Martha Graham gave it at the very last minute the title Appalachian Spring, and everybody comes up to me after the concert and says, "Oh, Aaron, I can see the mountains of Appalachia. It's just so amazing. I'd smell the dewdrops on the flowers." He's like, "I had no idea I was thinking of any of that when I wrote that piece." And so it's one of the things he actually uses to discredit the notion that music can have meaning. Turns out that Copland is fibbing a little bit too, because actually there was a story in this ballet, a scenario about a pioneer family that goes way back to his conversations with Martha Graham about what this might be. So it's really not that far off, but you know. So I would just, as you listen to tonight's concert, I would sort of move your attention maybe between these three planes that Copland talks about, between the sort of kind of intuitive, sort of physical, almost sensuous reaction to it, the idea of what might this mean, and then focus now and then on, like, well, who's playing? And, oh, that melody moved from the violins to the trumpets and then back to the bassoons, and focus on those sort of musical details that Copland was so fascinated with. Well, I hope you really love the concert. It's really going to be a fantastic evening. It's a very interesting program, I think, with the two adagios, the rare Bernstein work, and then one of the classics of American music. Enjoy.